Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Thank you so much for being with us. We really do appreciate it that you choose to spend this time with us. And all this week, we've been having some just fantastic guests, and I have to say it continues today. And a good part of what we're trying to do this week is a little bit of counter programming, because as each year, as we come up towards the anniversary of the Roe versus Wade decision, we get a great celebration of a certain view of women, a certain view of children, a certain view of family and community and all of that. And frankly, we think a lot of what is celebrated and what will be celebrated in coming weeks is not true. As a matter of fact, it leads to heartbreak and hurt. And so we said, let's get the smartest, most together, most impressive Catholic women that we can find and allow them a week to make the case for a different vision of our humanity, a different vision of our man and womanhood, our communities. And that's what we're doing. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884 on the number. That's the number if you'd like to get in on the conversation. The second hour, Liz Kelly will be here, and we're going to talk about women in the New Testament. And that's a lot of fun with Liz Kelly, and she's always a great guest. And this hour, we're going to talk about motherhood and how it became, I don't know, a four-letter word or some kind of great controversy. The motherhood, which always wasn't a controversy, now it is. And now this is probably the area where doing a week like this, where we're trying to provide the opposite vision of our humanity, you cannot get more to the nub of it than motherhood. It is brutally attacked in both physically and culturally. And yet it is the noblest thing a human being can do. So this hour, your questions about motherhood are welcome. Our guest for this hour, Beth I'm going to be able to talk. Don't worry. I just get excited about the guest. Beth Sree is our guest. She's the mother of 8 children and married to Catholic theologian Edward Sree, who is also called Ted Sree. You will hear her calling him Ted. She's a graduate of Benedictine College. She was among the very first focus missionaries. And if you don't know what focus missionaries are, you should find out all about it, especially if you've got young people. She's led numerous Bible studies and women's groups. She gives talks on marriage and motherhood, regularly mentors young women who are engaged or young moms. Beth Sree, thanks so much for being with us.
Thanks for having me, Cy. What a gift it is to be here.
I gotta say, mother of 8 children, have you never heard of global warming? Like, do you see what I'm saying? Like, I wonder about a mom of 8 children. You're like a walking billboard for an alternate lifestyle, the one that many people don't approve of.
Yep, absolutely. I'm a walking sign of contradiction.
Yeah.
Is what I like to say. Yeah, for a while it was just hilarious because I would meet new people and you get to talking and then they'd be like, wait, you have X amount of kids, whatever I had at that time. And I found it immediately they would all just look like, I'd be standing side to side with someone and they'd turn and like look at my midsection. And I'm like, what is happening? Why are you doing this? So I oftentimes will get to know people before I kind of, you know, feel them out and before I lay it all out with. Because eventually, you know, talk about your family and they talk about their family and, right. And well, I got this 14-year-old and this 12-year-old and then my 6-year-old, you know, and they're like, how many kids do you have? And it's always the, you have 8 kids? You know, people can't believe it. But I mean, to me, sometimes I'm like, I wish I had more, you know, oftentimes I wish I had more. They're the greatest blessings. I just love them all to pieces.
That's
such a gift.
That, but as you know, that's not the image of motherhood. It's a very conflicted image, I suppose, we have in our society. If you went back 100 years ago, you would not have to convince a woman that the things that you're describing as good things are good things. You wouldn't have to say motherhood and family are good things. But today, you often do, and you might even be mocked for saying that. What went wrong? What happened?
It's hard for me to, you know, go through and say everything. I mean, we can point to feminism, we can point to the sexual revolution, but I think a lot of it just boils down to we've lost our way. You know, as women, there's different goods that have been put in front of us and by society, by our culture, and we've lost our sense of where is goodness found. We get this notion that it's out there and I got to go get it, you know, instead of realizing, like, let's just bring it in and let's see it in front of us, you know, in the little people. that we're around and what we're capable of in our marriages, you know?
Yeah.
It's sad, but I don't think it's irreversible. I think it's completely redeemable in Jesus Christ and the Catholic faith. So,
well, one of the things that I worry about, in part, well, I have young adult daughters, and many of their friends and the young women that have grown up, I worry that they're going to postpone motherhood so much that they'll regret how much they postponed it. But I don't know. It seems like there's a kind of anxiety that they have to do these other things before they can be a mom. It doesn't seem like a joy, like, oh, I'm just so, but an anxiety. I have to do these other things before I'm a mom. What would you say to those young women?
Well, I used to be that, you know, when I first met Ted, one of our initial conversations is he said, what do you want to do when you're, you know, finished with college? And I just looked straight at him. And I said, I want to be the CEO of a large corporation. Uh-huh. And he was like, oh, okay. You know, he's a business major. I was going to take on the world and, you know, just do whatever needed to be done and make it happen, get it done. But it really was when I was introduced during the very first focus summer training to Catholic families, you know, and I saw the moms, I saw, you know, the larger families, I saw homeschooling, you know, and I just saw the dynamic and just how respectful they were and how much love there was. And I thought that right there is what I want. I want to run after that. And as I grew in my relationship with God, then it all kind of came together in a new way. So
that actually worries me a little bit, because there you need the image of that family to kind of be invited into that life, but there are fewer and fewer families who are giving that image.
Right, which is why I love to have people over to our house.
Uh-huh.
You know, we actually moved twice when we moved to Colorado. We bought our first house, and then the house we own now came up for sale. And I knew I wanted to get a house with a bigger backyard and a larger layout of the floor plan, because I wanted to be able to invite people over to my home. So, you know, our Lord says, you know, that his apostles say, well, where do you live? And he says, come and see.
Yeah.
And so I love to have people come over and see, whether it's interacting with my kids on the phone or helping us do family life. You know, I had someone come pick up a kiddo for me earlier today to take him to a soccer practice. And she came in, was wrestling with the little people. You know, I love being here for them and having them and just jump into our daily lives and see the crazy and the messy and the chaos and the beauty. And they remind me of how beautiful it is.
Right,
you know?
Right, yeah.
And that's such a joy, such a joy.
Beth Shree is our guest. We're talking about the vocation of motherhood this hour. If you'd like to talk about the vocation of motherhood, whether you're a Catholic person or not, whether you're capable of motherhood or not, half of us born completely incapable of it, but you might want to call and talk about it, maybe from the perspective of a parent who would like to talk to children about motherhood as a vocation. Maybe for some, you would like to settle some disputes within the family. You're welcome to call the Vocation of Motherhood, 888-318-7884. As I said, Beth Shree, our guest, mother of 8 children herself. And so you did kind of end up as the CEO of a major corporation. You just had to give birth to the entire corporation. So I think in some ways the war over motherhood is a war over images, and the image people have is, well, we're not going back to the 1950s, to which I always feel like the answer is, praise God, let's not go back to the 1950s. That was a terrible model. Mom stranded, essentially, you know, with children, instead of mom and children part of society. So what's your image, your healthy image of motherhood that you would like to see people living?
That's a great observation, just the 50s. I would say one thing that was good about the 50s was the fact that all the moms were home together, and yeah. So the neighborhood was a factor.
I got
you. The kids dart here and dart there, and that's kind of what we've landed in here in South Denver in our neighborhood. It's not the most aesthetically pleasing neighborhood in the world, but there's a lot of other great families. I mean, the kids came home half an hour before we started this broadcast, and one's on the phone calling a friend, and another one is already off on his hoverboard, off to see if his friends are there to come back and help watch the other kids. You know, there's this synergy of raising kids together within the neighborhood that that I would love to see everybody have, because it's been such a grace and a gift to our family to know that, you know, well, so-and-so down the street is trying to raise their kids the same way, or so-and-so down there, we know their family and we can talk about the movies y'all want to watch before they just start playing them, you know? So
right.
The idea that it takes a village, there's something to that if you can find like-minded folks in your backyard. So, that's part of it.
Beth Street is our guest. We're talking about the vocation to motherhood. You're welcome to call with any question you have about the vocation to motherhood. 888-318-7884 is our number. We'll take a quick break and come back with your calls. 888-318-7884. Before we take the break, I want to remind you, we have this thing that we're doing for Lent here at Catholic Answers. Lent is approaching. And if you want to sign up now, we're going to send out a Lenten apologetics lesson, something that you can learn about the Catholic faith each day all through Lent. It comes to your email. It's a short read, but you get a little bit of an education each day in the Catholic faith. If you'd like to get it, it's completely free. Just click on the banner at catholic.com or at shop.catholic.com. Go to either of those websites, catholic.com or shop.catholic.com, and get your free daily Lenten apologetics lesson.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The EWTN home video highlight for January is A Wolf in Sheep's Clothing 2, The Gender Agenda.
For two centuries, the ideologues of socialism or communism have used deceptive word jugglery to rebrand themselves as liberals or progressives.
Order your DVD at EWTNRC.com, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, or call 1-800-854-6316.
Hi, this is Cy Kellett. Don't forget to check out the latest episode of our podcast, Catholic Answers Focus. You can listen each week to the world's premier podcast on Catholic apologetics at CatholicAnswersFocus.com or subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Catholic Answers Focus, now available at CatholicAnswersFocus.com. It's not often that I feel like a guest that we're having on, this is the most relaxing part of their day, being on the air with us. But I feel like with Beth Street, this might be the most relaxing part of her day. She's the mother of eight, a former Focus missionary herself, here to talk to us about the vocation of motherhood. Beth, there are lots of folks on the line, and I do want to get to the folks on the line. And you're welcome to get up. There's a couple lines open, 888-318-7884. But I'm just going to throw out the tough – I want to ask you the toughest question. I think that most – no, I shouldn't say it that way. The message about motherhood that we get is it holds women back. Is that true? Does motherhood hold women back?
I would say in the things that matter, that's false. The things that matter, and that's where it's important to discern and distill your unique gifting and calling, because God wants you to do things, but he also wants you to fulfill your primary vocation. When it comes down to it, you'll be judged on your primary vocation, the big V, you know, not the little V of how you made it work, the big V of your family, your marriage, and to your husband, and then your children. I can say with total confidence, my oldest is 20 years old. So rewind 21 years to when I first found out I was pregnant with her. That person versus this person that you're talking to right now has been completely recreated and renewed in the gift of motherhood. It's, wow. I'm such, it's just, I can't even tell you, like birthing my babies, nursing my babies, raising my babies. You know, now my oldest is in college and she's, you know, kind of launched on her own. We're getting our 18-year-old is figuring out his college journey and his adult journey. Oh, I've grown in trust with the Lord in such a profound way. And I feel like I've understood what it means to be a child of God by seeing my kiddos grow and how they're all so unique. And I still love them to pieces. And how their gifts to me to stretch me to make me better, but also just for me to know how much God loves me.
Wow, you really sound like you're full of regret there, Beth. So that's a really remarkable to think. I love the thought experiment, the me that was 21 years ago when I got the news and the me today. And I suppose that's something I don't think about enough, but that the child, all these children are a gift to you to make you, to bring you to the fullness of the person you can be.
Absolutely. And they each teach me something new every day. And that could be just a simple thing of empathy. And my daughter, who's 4 today, collected rocks. You know, and rock collecting's not my favorite thing. It's a new thing for her, but she was so delighted to tell me what she named them all. And to be with her in that and rejoice and be down on her level and laugh about, ho ho, this one's named Pebble. You know, to me, these are the moments that I just want to store, you know, that I can pull out when I'm 90 years old and look back on and be like, those were the good old days. I don't want to miss the good old days that I'm living right now. Right. Wishing them away for something different or better or more flashy or shiny that society is offering.
Talking about the vocation of motherhood with Beth Sri, the mother of 8. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. Up first is Charles in Kingwood, Texas, listening on Catholic.com. Charles, thank you so much for your call. Please go ahead with your question for Beth Sri.
Yes, hello. So I would imagine many young people like myself have concerns with having large families or when to start a family due to monetary reasons, and just trying to find that balance between worrying about money and wanting to have as many children as possible. So at what point do you think it becomes unreasonable to put off having children because of monetary concerns?
That is a million-dollar question right there, Charles. I mean, there's so many people in this world that, you know, the cares of the world are real. You know, we need to pay attention to them. I would say the ultimate gift to your marriage, to the world, is the gift of another child. It's an immortal soul that will live forever. And we've struggled too. It's not like, you know, God just said, here's your money and you can have this many kids within this, you know, budget or something like that. I wish God had been that clear, right? Don't we all? There's a great proverb that I think I read in one of Kimberly Hahn's books. I forget which one exactly, but it stuck with me. And it's simply this: each child brings his own bread. And I love that because it's so true. You know, you might conceive a baby and think, oh, how are we going to do this? You know, diapers and then tuition or homeschooling supplies and then college. How, Lord? But when you're open to life and our Lord meets you in that openness and blesses it, it's not like he's abandoning you. He's going to sit with you in that and provide. He's going to provide for you and for that child. And we're seeing it right now. I mentioned we have kids in college and more that are up and coming in college. And I sometimes look at, you know, what we set aside and I'm like, there's no way. There's no way, you know, how is this going to cover anything, you know? But the Lord's providing. I can't say this enough. Like, when you really are open to the Lord's plan for your life and your marriage. And again, that's something that is very personal to each man and woman, to each husband and wife. It's something that has to be discerned truly monthly. But when you're truly open to where he's leading you, he's going to show you the way. And it's going to be bumpy. But I can look back and say, oh, I would do it 100 times over, you know, all the pain and all the grief, but all the joy and all the blessings of just being open and allowing him to lead you. And he does show up if you're faithful to what he's asking of you.
What do you think, Charles?
I think that's very good. You know, I think that's a good way to look at it, that each child is an immortal soul. And, you know, I think it just a lot of people kind of have a unreasonable fear of poverty, and that, you know, in some ways, poverty can be very good for people.
I never found that to be the case with myself, but no, I'm only kidding you, Charles. That's. I heard a financial planner one time on the radio here in San Diego, Beth. And thanks, Charles, very much for the call. And this guy was just an irascible guy on the radio. And someone said, "What's the biggest mistake you can make financially?" And he said, "Have children." And I thought, oh, it was brutal. It was a horrible thing to say. But, I mean, there's a certain realism to it. Yeah, they, you know, it costs money to have these children. And I do think there's a an exaggerated fear. I mean, for a lot of reasons. A lot of people today are children, for example, of divorce. And they think, I don't know if the marriage is going to last long enough to raise the children. Or they're just afraid of the, you know, not, I mean, there's even people who are afraid to have children because of the carbon footprint. Like, they just feel an inner responsibility. There's a lot of fear in the world these days.
Mm-hmm. So, and how many times say, don't be afraid in the Bible? Right. I think I heard 365 times, one for each day.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, I heard that recently. Hopefully it's true.
We're going with it, whether it is or not. We're going with it. Beth Sri is our guest. She's the mother of eight children, a former Focus Ministry, married to Edward Sri, theologian Edward Sri. Many people have read Dr. Sri's books. You don't call him Edward, though. You call him Ted.
I do.
And he doesn't mind that? He doesn't make you call him Dr. Edward Sri?
Sometimes I do when I want to tease him.
When you're mad?
Right. Edward.
All right. Let's go right here to California. Christina, right here in California, listening to EWTN Channel 130 on Sirius XM Satellite Radio. You are next with Beth Sri. Go ahead, Christina, with your question.
Yes. Hi, Beth. I love what you said about having a nice big house for people to come over and a nice yard for friends and everybody to come over. But I'm having such a difficult time with this pandemic, and you know, people are so afraid and so nervous and don't want to hang out in groups, and you know, my kids, I feel socially, are suffering because, you know, nobody wants to hang out, and I don't know what to do, and I don't know if you have any suggestions. I don't know if you know how, anything else that we can do to keep those connections and those friendships going and the socializing. I mean, I've always had an open door policy and the kids have always had people over, but for the last year, it's just been at a standstill because of everything. And it's so heartbreaking.
Yeah. Oh, Christina, I hear you. I mean, this year has been so traumatic. I mean, let's be honest, there's been trauma that's happened, you know, because of COVID and all the crazy. The biggest thing I would say is just pray, you know, ask your children's guardian angels to help them find like-minded friends. Ask your guardian angel to put you in touch with another person that's feeling the same way. Because you're not alone by any means. You're not alone. There are other people that are eager to, you know, safely make connections again. Here in Denver, it's been interesting too. You know, there's some that are very, very concerned, and then there's others that, you know, may have already had it or whatever, and they're eager to kind of bring things back. And even in parishes, I've seen a huge difference of the way that they approach things. So I don't know, maybe there's a parish that tends to attract more like-minded folks that you could kind of tap into as well and just try and go to Mass there a few times and make some connections. There's also, you know, the Zoom calls. My friends and I did that over, I think it was March and April. We'd all get together and have our drink and laugh and chat and connect and catch up. And it wasn't ideal, but it was something. It was something.
Okay, Christina.
All right. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Well, you're welcome. Thank you for the call, Christina. Our number is 888-318-7884. Our guest is Beth Sri. All this week, we're talking to some of the finest, sharpest Catholic women that we could find. In large part, and I've said this several times, and I want to keep saying why we're doing this. I do think that this month, Beth, I'd leave this if you wanted to say something about it, that the image of womanhood and what is liberating and empowering to women on offer is a lie. But I can't put it another way. That's what it is. The image that's given to us in Christ Jesus is not a lie. It really does liberate. It really does empower each and every human being, each and every man and woman and child. And so among these women that were agreed to come on with us, Beth Sri, mother of eight, to talk about the vocation to motherhood. Do you, as a mother, what I just said, I'm not going to try to make you talk like me, but you know, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, but do you have a concern about your own children and the image of motherhood and fatherhood that they are getting from the world?
In a certain sense, yes. you know, because there's a perception that life will be easier and less complicated, you know, if you aren't open to life, if you have less children. And to an extent, that's true. But I also would hope that my kids see there's nothing better than my siblings, you know, like, right. And I tell them all the time when they're fighting, you can't fight your best friends. You have to be best friends, you know, and I tell them when your dad and I are dead and gone, you will still have each other.
Yes, that's a great point about a great gift. But among the greatest gifts a parent can give is that brother or sister. You know, I have six brothers and sisters, and I love five of them. All right, we'll take a quick break. Be right back with more Beth 3 right after this.
Call now, Catholic Answers Live.
To many people, even many Christians, purgatory is a fantasy, or worse, a wicked lie invented by the church to make salvation complicated and keep people in fear. But I'm here to tell you that purgatory is fact, not fiction. The Bible supports it, Christians have historically believed in it, and it makes theological sense. In my new book, Purgatory is for Real, I provide the evidence and reasoning to help you understand this controversial doctrine and demonstrate how it's actually a joyful, hopeful reality, not something shadowy and mysterious, but a sign of God's love and mercy. To get your copy of Purgatory is for Real, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
If you spend any time on Twitter, Facebook, or mainstream media, you're probably familiar with the litany of slogans that skeptics employ to rescue you from the foolish belief that God exists. The constant onslaught seems to leave people with the idea that they have no alternative but to embrace atheism. How can a Christian respond? In One Less God Than You, John DeRosa breaks down 20 of the most common atheist challenges and shows you how to craft effective answers. Atheism is more aggressive and widespread than ever. Read One Less God Than You and prepare yourself to respond with the joyful truth that God is real. To get your copy of One Less God Than You, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you. I'm feeling groovy today. You feeling groovy, Nick? You feel groovy at all? Do you? Yeah, he feels a little groovy. You know, we usually play the groovy music. We do open forum on Thursdays. We're holding off on open forum today to talk to a couple of very, very fine guests. Second hour, Liz Kelly will be here. And we're going to talk about women in the New Testament. If you want to hear about some of the women you might remember from the New Testament, some you might not remember, but you want to hear about, you will want to hear about them with Liz Kelly the second hour. This hour, Beth 3 is here with us. Beth is the mother of 8 children, and so we asked her if she would talk to us about the vocation to motherhood. She's done many other things as well, and is happy to talk with you about the vocation to motherhood, 888-318-7884. By the way, if you think we're nuts, as always, you're welcome to call as well, 888-318-7884. Samantha in San Antonio, Texas, listening on the Guadalupe Radio Network. You are next, Samantha. Go ahead with your question for Beth 3.
Hi, Beth. Hi, Cy. Thank you so much for taking my call.
Hi, Samantha.
Really appreciate the program topic today.
Thank you.
I am in the thick of this vocation. I have 3 kids. 6 and under, 6, 4, and 1. And I'm just really struggling. I wanted to be a mom. And, you know, Beth, how you were talking about when you graduated, your husband asked you, what do you want to do? And you said, you want to be a CEO. When I graduated, my husband was in the Army, and I knew I wanted to start a family. I was tired of being away from my husband. I felt really strongly about being called to the vocation of motherhood. We, I became Catholic like right before I got married. So I'm a convert as of like 7 years now. And I really love the Catholic faith, but because I was raised in such a different culture, everything is so difficult for me to just feel supported in. I constantly feel like a sinking ship. I'm trying to do things that my support system doesn't necessarily understand or just can't give me the support that I need. And I always feel like I'm failing. I'm struggling so much with like mom guilt, and am I being kind enough to my children, which I think most of the time is a no for me.
Oh.
So I'm really struggling, and I want to have a large family, but I'm at three and I feel overwhelmed.
Thanks, Samantha. Beth?
Samantha, girl, I so feel you. I so feel you. I wish I could reach through your radio right now and give you the biggest mom hug and tell you, you are not failing. All the moms out there hearing Samantha and are resonating with that know that you are not failing. You might be struggling, and the struggle is real. That's not just a cliche here. I mean, if it wasn't worth doing, it'd be easy, right? But Samantha, especially having three kiddos, I remember when I had three kids and I literally thought I had stuff going on physically. I went to my doctor and said, I know I have this, just give me medicine. And he was a wise doctor. And he said, tell me about your youngest. Is she sleeping through the night? And I said, no, but they never do. And he's like, why don't you work on sleep and then come see me? He was a very wise doctor. And eventually she started sleeping and all of those perceived things kind of faded in the background. But three is hard because everybody is young. Everybody is dependent on you. Everyone needs you for everything all the time, right? And if your husband, I don't know if he's still in military or if, I don't remember what you said, if he's still there or not. But I mean, especially if your husband's busy and all the family stuff is on you, like, wow, that's a lot. But know this. That once, this is what I found, when I found that I invested in my kiddos when they were young, then as they grew up, they were able to help more. So that to me was, I didn't realize I was even doing it. But I also realized, like looking back, if I could talk to myself when I had three kiddos, I would say, girl, get some self-care going. And that can look like different things for different people. Self-care could be, you know, taking a bubble bath and reading a book, you know, several times a week, or it could be going out for a run or meeting a friend for coffee or, you know, time in the chapel. Like that is one of my main sources. Or it could be even therapy. Maybe there's some deeper stuff going on that you might want to be sorting out. Maybe it's our Lord is telling you it's time, Samantha, to look at some things. It could be a lot of things, but that's where it's really important to find some time to recharge your own batteries, because you can't give what you don't have. And you want to give the best of yourself to your kids. So it's time, you got to sometimes pull back and realize, how can I fill my own tank? How can I plug into the graces that Jesus is wanting to give me so that I can give the best to my children? And it's a daily battle. I can attest to that. I have probably more rough days than easy days, but it's getting back up on the horse every single day, every single time. It's saying I'm sorry to the little kids, because that's teaching them as well. When you say, I'm sorry I yelled, mommy lost her temper, I'm really sorry, please forgive me. And you're teaching them that how an apology works and how you offer forgiveness. Don't waste it. That's the biggest thing. Don't waste the time, but also know it's rough and know that it will get easier if you persevere. But
Samantha, I'm interested in your response.
Oh, I feel like most of my communication with my children is an apology. Just the constant asking for forgiveness. It's super humbling being a mom, or parents in general. But my husband's not in the military anymore, but he is very busy with his work now. And we own a business as well as having a full-time job. So very, very kind of stretched thin sometimes. And I realize the need for self-care. It's just like the logistics of it. I've really got to prioritize it more. And I know that. But yeah, the sleeping thing that your doctor said, absolutely. I have a one-year-old that still wants to nurse like every 2 hours at night. And I'm like, when are you going to grow out of this?
Oh, yeah. You're still in the really hard stuff, Samantha. Yeah. And you know, you mentioned that you're a convert to the faith. If I may just add to that, my wife is a convert to the faith, and getting acclimated to all this Catholic stuff and all these Catholic people and the way we do things and think, that's a lot of work as well. So you've got that job on top of the mom job. You got a lot going on, Samantha.
Sure.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I'll pray to you, Samantha. Sorry. I'll pray that you find some good Catholic friends too that can walk with you. Because that's, I think, when you can just get together with your girlfriends and just laugh about the crazy and know that you're not alone in it, that's half the battle as well, to just have some partners in crime, so to speak. It can really be a game changer to have that fellowship and community.
Thank you, Samantha. I'm going to keep moving. Lots of folks on the line. As a matter of fact, all the lines full, but as one line opens up, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. We're talking about the vocation to motherhood with our guest, Beth Shree, this hour. She's the mother of 8 children. And maybe you could say something about the idea of vocation, because this too, I mean, thinking of Samantha as coming into the Catholic Church, those of us who were raised from the time we were children as Catholics, we've heard the word vocation since we were little. But what do you mean by that when you call it the vocation to motherhood? And why does it help to think of it as a vocation?
I mean, it makes it all worthwhile. It gives you the idea to persevere when you think of, you know, small v vocation is what you do to earn a living or what brings in, you know, your sustenance, so to speak. Big V vocation is your path to sanctity, your path to holiness, your path to heaven, to unity with our Lord. And that's, you know, three ways: the consecrated life, the religious or priesthood, or marriage. So when you're saying marriage is your primary vocation, your stairway to heaven, it's all the little things that you encounter in that, that I think of it as like the, you know, Michelangelo's David. You know, when we start off, we're just the plain block. We're that block of marble. And then each day, through a series of simple yeses in our vocation, God carves us and carves us and chips off the chunks of marble to create his masterpiece. So that's I think, all the vocations. All of them are going to encounter struggle and strife and suffering. There's no escaping that. But the question is, are we going to run from it? Are we going to numb ourselves out? Or are we going to go and sit in it with Jesus and allow him to teach us through those times?
Beth Shree is our guest. We're talking about the vocation to motherhood. Why do you think that, it, like, when you talk about that, it, like, we celebrate the person who would suffer to become, as you said, the CEO of the company, or the person who would suffer to become the great sports star. And then we act like it's, if a mother, you know, motherhood brings suffering. There's no way around that. But we don't value that suffering. Somehow that suffering's not the right kind or something.
Yeah, it seems like society kind of flips things on their on its head, right? You know, like you said, the stuff that's in the spotlight, the people that are out there, you know, getting the accolades, you know, it's not like someone's, every time we change a diaper, someone's like, yeah, you know, screaming. In the
you
crowd.
Did it, girl! Yeah.
I know, it'd be kind of weird if that was the case. But, you know, that I do think that there's something to the quiet side of motherhood, you know, the middle of the night, like Samantha was talking about, midnight feedings and the nursings and just what your body goes through, you know, pregnancy and delivery and all that's involved there. I mean, it really is the cross. Yeah. But that's where we get also get the resurrections. We get the front row seat, you know, for seeing the firsts of our babies, their first steps, their first words, you know, their first A on a test and all the first rock collection like my 4-year-old had today. You know, that those are the joys. Those are the resurrections. Those are the fruit of those sufferings and of all the time and energy that we put in. And it really is something that I believe deep in my heart that brings great joy to our Lord when we do these simple yeses in the silence of our homes in the middle of the night. And I think he loves it because it reminds him of his own mom, you know, Our Lady, that she did so much behind the scenes in silence to support and just really integrate his teaching and his life and his love within her own life and heart. And that's what we're all called to in some way, shape, or form.
Beth Shree is our guest. We're talking about the vocation to motherhood this hour. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. We do have to take a quick break. Before we go, I want you to know that, you know, we have the School of Apologetics. We started the School of Apologetics, more and more classes up all the time, and they are first class. I mean, the video department here is just putting together great, great work. You can find out all about it at schoolofapologetics.com. But one of the latest courses is the moral apologetics for the moral teaching of the church, what the church teaches on right and wrong, basically, is what it is. And it's 60% off right now. If you go over to schoolofapologetics.com, it's 60% off. They're doing that for Respect Life Month. It's pro-life month this month because January is the anniversary of the Roe versus Wade decision. So take a course, get 60% off, and be fully prepared to defend the moral vision of the Catholic Church. You go to schoolofapologetics.com to get that deal.
Hello, this is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Keep your dial tuned to Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
He was a doctor of the church, a Carmelite, and one of the most famous mystics of all time.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
St. John of the Cross wanted to help all Christians to become saints. One of his most important teachings was to encourage us all to learn how to love. Where there is no love, he said, put love, and you will find love. He died in 1591.
For more about the Doctors of the Church, visit doctorsofthechurch.com.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live, this hour devoted to the vocation of motherhood, a much maligned or much conflicted vocation in the modern world. If you have questions about the vocation of motherhood, 888-318-7884 is the number. Our guest is Beth Shree. She is the mother of eight herself, and happy to help you as you consider the vocation of motherhood, whether for yourself or something you'd like to understand, or even if you'd like to challenge us a bit. 888-318-7884. Let us go back to the phones. Let's go to Teresa in Florida. Teresa, you there with us?
Yes, I am.
Hi, Teresa. Thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question for Beth Shree.
Thank you. I've never done this before. I listen all the time to Eternal Word Network, but I've never called in before. But I had such an inkling when I said, I think that I have an answer for some of the mothers.
Oh, you do?
First of all, as I told the young lady who answered the phone, I never said this to her, but my mother, I'm a convert. And my mother thought it was absolutely terrible that I had three children, with the eldest being 2 years and 9 months old. It was absolutely unbelievable that my husband and I should take such a liberty with children.
Aye.
So my husband, this is a good one. My husband turned around to his mother-in-law, and said, well, you know, mother, I will tell you something. It took two of us. So... She never mentioned it again. So that was
she didn't want to think about that, Teresa.
It was, you know, just for the laugh. But, you know, I wanted to say that I had three children that early, you know, like that. Then I lost two children. And then when I was 42, I found out that I was pregnant. I am a mother of four living children, 10 grandchildren. So I have lots of fun. So anyway, when I was pregnant at 42 years old, a lady I was quite friendly with, she thought it was abhorrent. Oh, my God, she said, you're pregnant at 42? Oh, that's terrible. So I said, in answer, I said, well, I will say something to you. I think that I had my children, so I made up for the ones that you never had.
Ooh. Wow.
Beth, do you want to get, Teresa, you have a very, very positive attitude about mothering. I appreciate that. Beth, did you want to respond to what Teresa had to say?
I love it, Teresa. I love your wisdom. And I think we do need to kind of push back in boldness like you did there. And I've had other people put it together as I say, you know, I have six kids and, well, I don't have any. So thank you for having the kids I never had, you know, secular folk that I've been in conversation with. And it kind of like jarred me. But in a way, it's kind of true. And unfortunately, because I think there's regret in that. Yeah, but the world needs more people in it. I can't emphasize this enough that when you say yes and you are pregnant, that you're having another, you're welcoming another soul into your family, into your life, that is an infinite gift, not only to the eternal realm in heaven, but to humanity
right.
on this earth.
Yeah.
It's an unrepeatable person. And it is a gift to humanity. It sounds grandiose and crazy to say that, you know, who are you to say that? But each child is just that kind of gift. It really is.
That doesn't, you know, it doesn't sound grandiose to me, but it sounds like something people somehow got talked out of. Like I don't know. Teresa, did you want to follow up with anything? We really appreciate your call.
No, I want to allow you to have other people to speak, but I just thought I was having a good laugh to tell you the truth because I thought, oh my goodness, if I ever told half the people what I said about children, I said, yes, you know, like, they're very good. I said, especially when they're asleep.
Of course. That, yes, that's true of them. Teresa, yes. Thank you very much. Can we put Teresa in the fun accent file? Yeah. So yeah,
yes,
we have a file of people whose accents we like. Well, Teresa, thanks very much for that call from Florida. Our number is 888-318-7884. Beth Shree is our guest, the mother of eight. And you've sent one off to college now?
Yep. Getting prepared to launch another one this fall.
And
then the slip trip begins.
Yeah. And then the you kind of found in focus as a missionary, you yourself found your calling. Do you worry about what's the situation where they're going to find their calling? Or do you talk to them about that? Do you talk to them about the vocation of parenthood?
Totally. I mean, I talk with, you know, my sons about, you know, providing, and Ted more than I, because that's his home game. It's not really my home game at this point in life. But yeah, it's come up with my daughter as she's choosing majors and what to study and minors and things. And I can see from my friends who have kind of a side gig, you know, what pairs well, if you will, with motherhood, you know, maybe a photography business or graphic design or, you know, organization, things like that, that me knowing her gifts can kind of encourage her. So she's pretty receptive for the most part.
Right. There's something very practical about it, that a choice of a career for a woman who's, say, in her early 20s, who intends to be a mother,
right.
there are things that are going to go with that motherhood vocation and things that are going to make it really tough.
Right. And I don't want to say, like, you can't be a doctor. You know, if right. God places one of my daughters or a lawyer or something, you know, that great call, then that's just going to, it's more complicated. But if it truly is what our Lord wants for her, then the pieces will all come together at the proper time. So I don't want to like poo-poo, but at the same time, I want to balance, like, discern your call, move in that direction, but don't be afraid if something changes, then we can deal with this, or we have things in place. But if you keep going, then know this, this, and this. Do you see what I'm saying? It's kind of like,
yeah,
set the stage for your kids. But as they grow in free will, they grow in their ability to choose for themselves and to make their own mistakes. And it's both terrifying and glorious at the same time.
But I feel like when you talk about this, we should also talk about the fact that many women who, like, for example, want to be in the corporate world, the corporate world is not designed to welcome them as women. It's only designed to welcome them as you know, an imitation of a man in many ways, especially when it comes to pregnancy. We had a guest on earlier in the week who said she noticed, as a she was a high powered lawyer in a law firm, she said she noticed it was nothing formal, but there was a two kids rule that people would start to look at these women lawyers differently if they went beyond two kids, three. Like, is this going to be a problem? Is this going to get in the way of your work? And you can't say those things out loud, but you can communicate them. I mean, we're human beings. People find a way to communicate these things. So I guess all that is to ask you, like, do you have any sense that the world could actually do a better job of making it so that moms could be moms and also have, whether it's a part-time or a full-time job?
Yes, obviously. The world could be way more welcoming to the feminine genius, as John Paul II calls it. You know, there's so much that we have to offer, you know, to whether it's the corporate world or retail or whatever it is. And there are things that, you know, can make us as moms come alive and refill our tank, as we were talking about earlier with Samantha.
Right.
That we can take then into our home. For instance, way back in the day, I helped out with a consignment sale, happened twice a year, and I got to use my business skills to like volunteer for the sale. And I remember Ted once popped in to say hi or something on his way home during the sale. And I was like, you know, and he's like, you're so happy. Like, how are you so happy? Because I got to like pull out my old skills, you know, and show him the light of day. It was really fun. But then I was able to go home and be more joyful and have more energy. And now I get that kind of, it's not a rush per se, but just there's things I do within my day. We talk with a friend, I go for a run, then I come home and helps just fill me up and get me focused more on, okay, what needs to happen? We need to tidy this. We need to make dinner. We need to pack lunches. And how are you? How are you? How are you? What do we need to do? How are you checking in? Are you feeling good? You know, where are we at within the family? And it gives more energy to my spirit to jump back in with a vigor. So I think there are ways that we can plug into those gifts and talents, but always bring it more, bring that energy back to the home and give the best of ourselves within the family.
If I may add another question about the vocation to motherhood, that is, sometimes I think from a person from the vantage point of their 20s, a young woman in the vantage point of their 20s, life looks like, well, if I have, you know, children, if I have a good brood of children, then that's my choice in life and that's what I am. But I've noticed now that I'm in my 50s that there are a lot of women my age, women that I went to school with and whatnot, who are like, well, that actually was, it was just part of my life. The kids are in college now, and now I'm doing that career that I didn't, they themselves are realizing it's motherhood, as wonderful as it is not a life sentence, so to speak, that there are seasons in life. And I know some women who are just delighted in their 50s that, hey, I'm doing that business thing that I never did.
Totally. And I love that you said seasons, because I feel like there are just so many seasons of life. And when you have a large family, they tend to overlap. You know, you've got the baby, you might have the toddler, and you have the grade school kid, and then the middle school and the high school. And that's where we're at right now. But we're starting to see the slow exodus of kids as they're growing and leaving. But there are seasons. There's a season to get up in the middle of the night. There's the season to have a growing belly and a back that hurts constantly. There's a season to have papers and stress. And, you know, there's just, it comes and goes. It ebbs and flows.
Yeah.
And it's never static. It's always changing. And it's always requiring you to respond, react, to learn, to accommodate, to empathize, to discipline. You know, it's drawing the best of us out for the good of others. And that's true. You know, like my baby's going to be in school next year.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to have all day, every day, you know, for 6 hours by myself. I'm like, what am I going to do with myself? You know, I'm entering a new season.
Yeah.
And I'm excited, but also sad. And we can hold those within us at the same time.
Right. I'm in the growing belly and my back hurts all the time season. Is that what you were talking about, or was it something else? Beth Sri, you are a superstar. I hope we'll get to do this again. Thank you so much for taking the hour for us.
Absolutely, Cy. This was a blast. Thanks for having me.
It's just been great. Hey, we've got another great hour coming up with our good friend Liz Kelly, and we're going to talk about women in the New Testament. Some women that you know, some you might have met, but you forgot. Maybe some you didn't notice, and all with a lesson for us about our relationship with the Lord. We'll do that right after this on Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and that was fun getting to talk with Beth Sree. This hour, another great guest, Liz Kelly, the author of a whole bunch of books, including, I just wanted to mention right up the front, Jesus Approaches, What Contemporary Women Can Learn About Healing, Freedom, and Joy from the Women in the New Testament. Among her several books, maybe the most pertinent today, because we're going to talk about women in the New Testament. So I welcome your call, 888-318-7884. You want to talk about the New Testament? You want to talk about particularly a woman or women in the New Testament? Maybe you want to talk about Jesus's own treatment of women in the New Testament. You are welcome to call 888-318-7884. Liz Kelly, thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Oh, and it's lizk.org. That's where people can find you online, right?
Correct. That is right.
Well, I was just mentioning your among your many books, Jesus Approaches, What Contemporary Women Can Learn About Healing, Freedom, and Joy from the Women in the New Testament. It's possible that someone might have read the New Testament and say, I didn't notice that many women in there.
Yeah, I've had that experience myself.
So what do you say to that person?
Well, it's funny because for about 10 years or so in Catholic studies at the University of St. Thomas, where I've been teaching, I taught a course called Woman and Man. And it's really about complementarity in between men and women in the church and their roles in vocation, that sort of thing. And in some ways, that was really the introduction for me to just a deeper look at the role of women in the church. And then I combined that with some years later, going through the exercises of St. Ignatius of Loyola, you know, praying in a very deliberate and a very scheduled, disciplined way through the New Testament. And it was funny in that experience how often women kept showing up. And how often they kind of kept popping out of the pages at me. And maybe it was because I had been primed with, you know, all these years of teaching woman and man. But I think it was sort of a convergence of these two things that kind of took a veil down for my eyes. And then, of course, I began to see the feminine influence all over. And I also began to understand just historically, you know, why there was less emphasis on women in the early church. And I mean, that's a longer conversation, but you know, the first apostles were working with pagans who believed in feminine deities. And there was, you know, there were a lot of, different parts that were trying to, be very, very clear about who Jesus was and not wanting to confuse people's about pagan deities, feminine deities in general. Anyway, that's a longer story. But, you know, once I started to, curiously, it's like I'd done the reading, I'd done the research, I'd done the study, but once I started praying with the scriptures in that way, that's when the women really started to kind of present themselves and populate the imagination of my soul with, you know, their presence and their affect.
888-318-7884 is our number. We're talking about women in the New Testament with Liz Kelly this hour. Your calls are welcome. If you have a question about women in the New Testament or a particular woman in the New Testament, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. So Liz, in your reading, and the women of the New Testament are coming alive for you, kind of standing out now. How did you come to think about how Jesus treats women?
Well, it's easy to discover that because there are examples of it. You know, we don't have to go into our imagination. There are various and numerous and a wide variety of ways in which he interacts with the women around him, drawing them into his work. Relying upon them to, you know, help probably keep him fed and cleaned and, you know, on the road during his public service. There's obviously the relationship that he had with his mother. He was mothered and as well as fathered here in the year of St. Joseph. We have to give a nod to St. Joseph,
Amen.
Of course. But So you don't have to look very far. You know, you don't really have to look very far. And when the book came out, my archdiocese asked me to put together a study based on that, based on the book. And in that, I looked even further at scriptures and Christ's very specific kind of interactions with women to get a cue from them. And, you know, he treats them with so much dignity and with such, I don't even want to use the word equality because that's got so much baggage with it. But, you know, he was a master at seeing and receiving the fullness of every person before him, man, woman, child. And there was a way that he interacted with women that I think we really need to pay attention to, because it's what also then directs how the church interacts with women and the ways that they unleash women to work in the world.
Ah, that's it. Okay, I see your point. So, right, because if we're going to take our clues from Jesus about how mm-hmm. we treat people, then how he treats each individual group of people is going to really set the stage for how those people are treated even today.
Well, yes, but also it's like, I think even beyond that, you know, we could make the statement that he sees the unique and unrepeatable beauty and reality of every soul before him, whether they are a man, a woman, or a child. And that has to color everything when we start talking about complementarity. How did he treat women? How did he treat men? How did he treat children? You know, how did he right. treat the Samaritans or whatever? That's the primary lesson that we need to pull from that he sees the individual and therefore he sees you with all of the nuance that makes up you. And there's no part of you have to leave on a shelf in order to interact with him. You know, you're being male or female or this or that or whatever, that we can bring ourselves in our wholeness to him and be received by him in our wholeness. And I think that's important just to mention because, you know, there were many women who did approach him.
Right.
And right. they approached him with their wounds and their pasts and their histories and their failures and their needs and their hopes and dreams. And there wasn't any part of them as women that they had to leave behind. They could come as the whole persons that they were.
888-318-7884. We're talking about women in the New Testament this hour with our guest, Liz Kelly. Among her many books, I mean, she's written 50 Reasons I Love Being Catholic, Heaven in You, You in Heaven, Unveiling Eternity on Earth, and others. But I'll just mention Jesus Approaches, What Contemporary Women Can Learn About Healing, Freedom, and Joy from the Women of the New Testament. 888-318-7884 is the number. Liz, are there women, like if someone said to you, well, give me a woman that you admire in the New Testament. Does anybody jump out at you?
Oh, I think Magdalene is probably she was the first chapter that I finished.
Uh-huh.
And she kind of became an anchoress for the rest of the book. And the scene, of course, that just moves the heart and so deeply is her. Everybody else has left the tomb. And she's going to stay behind. You know, she just can't bear the thought of not being near, you know. So she's going to the tomb. She doesn't have any idea how she's going to open up, you know, move the stone. It's way too big for her to move. But, you know, all of that is secondary. You know, she's just going in search of the one she loves. And in turn, what she discovers is that the one who loves finds her. And I think that's, you know, a microcosm for the whole Christian life. And it's just captured so beautifully in the New Testament in that scene, you know, when she falls and tries to cling to Jesus and he calls her by name, you know, and that is what he does for all of us. He calls us by name. He comes in search of us and we end up discovering him.
Again, our number 888-318-7884. We're talking with author Liz Kelly about women in the New Testament. You're very welcome to call. I have to take a quick break, however, before we get to the calls. 888-318-7884. We're giving away a free ebook right now at shop.catholic.com, and it's about Lent. It's 20 answers. Lent, if you got questions about Lent, we got 20 answers about Lent for you. Just head over to shop.catholic.com, and you get it free in the ebook format, shop.catholic.com.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
The Aquinas Writing Advantage Program is part of Homeschool Connection's set of online courses for your Catholic homeschool. Homeschool Connections website is homeschoolconnections.com.
I firmly believe that prayer is communication with God. And if we know that God is a loving Father, why wouldn't we want to talk to God? The reality is we've got to talk to our family, we've got to talk to our friends, and if God is real, and God is definitely real, He wants to hear about our day. He also wants to know how we're doing and what our needs are. Prayer is communication with God.
Hi, this is Cy Kellett. Don't forget to check out the latest episode of our podcast, Catholic Answers Focus. You can listen each week to the world's premier podcast on Catholic apologetics at CatholicAnswersFocus.com or subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Catholic Answers Focus, now available at CatholicAnswersFocus.com.
How can a human woman be God's mother? Where in the Bible does it say that Mary was sinless and a perpetual virgin? What can I do to build and deepen my relationship with Mary as my spiritual mother in heaven? In 20 Answers Mary, you'll find biblical evidence for Marian doctrine and devotion, answers to common objections to Catholic teachings about Mary, and guidance on how to imitate Christ as you get to know the Blessed Mother like you've never known her before. 20 Answers Mary is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com today and take a look at this exciting new series from Catholic Answers Press.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Liz Kelly is our guest. You can find her at Liz K, L-I-Z-K, at, .org. I was going to say at. I'm going to learn the internet ways one of these days. Among her many books, Jesus Approaches, What Contemporary Women Can Learn About Healing, Freedom, and Joy from the Women of the New Testament. Our topic this hour is the women of the New Testament, and you are welcome to call with your questions, 888-318-7884. So what can women take from the women of the New Testament? What did you find as you studied the women in the New Testament?
You know, I think more than anything, I was just so heartened to see in a new and a deeper and a very real way their presence and the import of that. You know, as we were saying before, Jesus was mothered.
Right.
He was wildly, deeply influenced and formed by the Blessed Mother, and that I think just lends a dignity to motherhood that can't be undone. But I think also that he had very real and close relationships with women, in that friendships, they were sort of like sister brother kinds of relationships, and he also put women to work. You know, he sends the Samaritan woman back into the very crowd she's trying to avoid. You know, they call her the apostle to the apostles, or, you know, one of the first missionaries. I'm sorry, I got Magdalene mixed up there. She was the apostle to the apostles. But, you know, he gave them work. He gave them really important, very serious works to do. And the fact that, you know, they were present at some of the most important moments in all of human and Christian history, you know, namely the resurrection. You know, if he was interested in establishing a kingdom of power, he would have first appeared to the kings, the wealthy, the rulers of the world. And that's not what he does. You know, instead, he appears to the lowly, the kind of nameless, those who didn't have a great deal of import in the culture, and says, I'm going to entrust this incredible moment, this extraordinary gift to you. You know, there can't be anything more dignifying than that. There's just a lot to explore. But I mean, that's definitely one of the things that I take away from that, is that women have a role to play, and it's a really important one.
Do you see that in the, I mean, you mentioned scenes from the Gospels, but in the, for example, the letters of St. Paul are about, mostly about the community that came later, or the Acts of the Apostles. Mm-hmm. Do you see this continuing role for women that even might be surprising for the ancient world in the other parts of the New Testament as well?
Yeah, I think so. I would say, you know, I'm less familiar with the letters of Paul. I'm not certainly not an expert on that at all. But I do think that, again, there's a clear evidence that women were continuing to participate in the evangelization of the world around them. That can't be overlooked or understated.
Amen. Amen to that. 888-318-7884 is our number. 888-31-TRUTH. I suppose I shouldn't leave out men in considering this. Like, I'm asking you these questions as if Jesus' treatment of women is basically a question that women would want answered. But actually, Jesus' treatment of women gives us a lot of information about how men should treat women. What do you take from that?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think that's a good way to put it too. Just a sense of everyone has their role to play. And I think that in observing Jesus's interactions with women, what we take away from that as a church is, again, just an emphasis in that we all have our role to play. It's not going to be the same role. We're, you know, part of the church body. Somebody's a heart, somebody's an ear, somebody's a hand, somebody's the nose, you know, whatever. I have a colleague, she's just filled with energy. I call her the adrenal gland of the church body, you know. Yeah. So it's like everybody has their spot to their role to play, and they're all important. You know, if you don't have a brain, the heart doesn't have much to do, you know, and so on and so forth. So it's like we need all of these different parts. And I think for a long time, women have felt sort of have been times and examples of when women have been separated or taken apart, set aside as if their roles were not equally important, even if they're different. You know, I'll never be a father. It's physically, metaphysically impossible for me to father. And yet fatherhood is a critically important role. You know, what I can be is a mother, you know, and that's a critically important role. So the fact that I can't be one or the other doesn't negate the other. It only, again, points to the fact that we were created for communion. And this is reflected in every aspect of life and vocation in particular.
Shall we go to calls? There's callers on the line for you.
Sure.
All right. Liz Kelly is our guest. We're talking about women in the New Testament. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. Whether you're Christian or not, whether you're Catholic or not, your call is always welcome here. 888-318-7884. I'll just mention again, among Liz's books, Jesus Approaches, What Contemporary Women Can Learn About Healing, Freedom, and Joy from the Women of the New Testament. Who's up first? Vladimir in Delaware, listening on the EWTN app. Vladimir, you there with us? Happy to do it. Vladimir, go ahead with your question for Liz.
Yes, my question is, did Mary Magdalene have children?
Mm-hmm. I think that tradition tells us no, that she remained celibate for the rest of her life. And but that's a good question.
Is that a Dan Brown kind of question? Are you is that where you're coming from, Vladimir?
When I'm listening to you guys talk about Mary Magdalene, and for some reason I just said, I wonder if she had children when all this was happening to her. when she, you know, when she met Jesus, and I don't know. So I just wanted to see if you knew something I didn't know.
I just wrote another book called Love Like a Saint, Learning the Virtues with Holy Women. And I did a great deal of research on Magdalene for a chapter in that book. And I've read pretty much everything I could find to get my hands on. And there are a number of different traditions that have sprung from Magdalene, but I don't ever recall ever seeing any evidence that she had had children, either before her encounter with Christ or after. But again, I'm not the last word on that.
You are today. 888-318-7884, the number. 888-31-TRUTH. Vladimir, thank you very, very much. I wasn't trying to be a smart aleck to Vladimir, but there's this Dan Brown idea that Jesus and the Magdalene were married. I don't... That doesn't seem to me to be supported by any evidence. I don't know how you feel about it.
No, it's certainly, well, that Jesus was married, certainly not. that Magdalene was ever married, no, certainly not. We don't have any evidence to suggest that at all.
Jesus, I want to ask you about Jesus with the woman caught in adultery, because we read that story as Jesus, the merciful Savior, and it is just shot through with mercy and also, in a certain sense, it's mercy with a little irony to it, in that he tweaks the men. Like, okay, go ahead. Right?
Sure.
But it also comes at the end with, now go and sin no more. So there's a way in which his mercy, I don't think we should, I guess what I'm trying to get at is, there's a kind of sentimentalized idea of mercy, and that's not what Jesus gives men or women.
I agree. I think mercy and justice come as a package. And I've been reading a lot of St. Maximilian Kolbe. He's sort of my saint for the year. I've been spending my mornings with him. And, you know, he was crazy about the Blessed Mother. And he did his doctoral work on the Immaculate Conception and so on and so forth. And he talks about how, you know, justice comes through Jesus and mercy comes through Mary. And, you know, he's just talking about, how, again, a sense of complementarity between these two attributes. And mercy isn't mercy without the truth. You know, it's not merciful to say to tell someone a lie. You know, it's not, that's not merciful. So of course Christ, in coming to the woman caught in adultery, or to the Samaritan woman, telling her whole life, you know, leaving out no detail of sin, you know, kind of really giving her the whole scoop, but at the same time, you know, giving her, despite this past, important work to do, and giving her the capacity to, an opportunity to receive forgiveness, and so that she can and absolution, so that she can go on and do work for the kingdom. And that's essential for all of us, that you know, despite whatever the sins are, we have the capacity to receive absolution and then be given an assignment and go back out to work in the kingdom. And it's not, you know, and especially in this day and age, I remember making a joke about my weight. I can't even remember what it was, but, you know, especially like, a lot of people know I have MS. I'm not, you know, quiet about it, and I've gained a lot of weight since I've been diagnosed, and that's not uncommon. I was making a joke about it, and this younger person was mortified that I would ever make fun of the fact that I was overweight. And, you know, and for my husband and I, it's like one of our chief sources of jokes around the house. You know, it's just so the fact that we can be honest with who we are. I mean, I think there's an element in our culture right now, the whole kind of snowflake idea that you can't ever say anything negative about anybody. But that's not at all the model that we had with Jesus.
No.
Jesus would be very, just very truthful. He'd be gentle. Sometimes he was much more firm, you know, but for most of those who were able to receive it, he was very gentle with the truth, and it did not discount them. You know, their failures, their weaknesses, their past did not discount them. They were offered mercy. They could receive it and be welcomed back into the church community.
And it's not a pat on the head like, well, go on your way, little lady. It's a very,
right.
It treats her as a very capable moral agent.
And you consider, you know, we know now she's probably coming to, I'm thinking of the Samaritan woman now, but, you know, she's coming to the well at noon to avoid those who would chide her. Oh. And she goes directly back into that group.
Oh, what a great point, Liz. Yeah.
You know, here's somebody who's told me everything I know. That takes some guts.
Liz Kelly's our guest. Sorry, the music's playing. I'm sorry to cut you off, Liz, but we'll be right back with more about women in the New Testament on Catholic Answers Live.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Bishop Joseph Strickland of Tyler, Texas, is one of the most courageous leaders in the church, known for his outspoken support of unborn life, Orthodox faith and morals, and reforming Catholic institutions. In his groundbreaking new book, Light and Leaven, he offers a forthright perspective on the state of the church today and calls on the lay faithful to meet its challenges boldly. Touching on topics including parish renewal, the centrality of the Eucharist, the need for prayer and silence in a noisy and distracted age, and the battle between good and evil in the church and world, Bishop Strickland's wise insights and evident love for souls will inspire and edify you. To order your copy of Light and Leaven, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
To many people, even many Christians, purgatory is a fantasy, or worse, a wicked lie invented by the church to make salvation complicated and keep people in fear. But I'm here to tell you that purgatory is fact, not fiction. The Bible supports it, Christians have historically believed in it, and it makes theological sense. In my new book, Purgatory is for Real, I provide the evidence and reasoning to help you understand this controversial doctrine and demonstrate how it's actually a joyful, hopeful reality, not something shadowy and mysterious, but a sign of God's love and mercy. To get your copy of Purgatory is for Real, visit shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
It's a big day for Liz Kelly. She's our guest, and we're playing the groovy music for her. That is very lucky. Only the best guests get the groovy music. Nick must have decided she's earned it. I guess she's earned it that first half hour, huh, Nick? That's the groovy music, Liz. You like that?
I do indeed. I wish you had a little jazz back there, but, you know, that's okay. I'll take groovy.
Well, we're not that. We're not cool. We're groovy.
Oh,
all right?
Okay. So
if you got to be cool to play jazz.
Oh, got it.
Our number is 888-318-7884. We're talking about women in the New Testament. If you have a question about women in the New Testament, you are welcome to call our guest, Liz Kelly. You can also find out all about her at lizk.org. Lizk.org. Your Heart, His Home, A Prayer Companion. That's Liz's. Heaven in You. In You, You in Heaven, Unraveling Eternity on Earth. That's another of her books. 50 Reasons I Love Being Catholic. And she had to shorten the list. She could have done more than 50.
Yes.
She had absolutely to shorten that list. And the book that's probably most germane to what we are talking about right now, and I'm basically showing off using big words like germane, Jesus Approaches, What Contemporary Women Can Learn About Healing, Freedom, and Joy from the Women in the New Testament. Do you ever feel like as a Christian woman, educated in the faith, you have to defend the faith against the accusation that it's anti-feminine?
Oh, sure.
You do?
Sure. Oh, sure. Even to other Catholics who might not be very well formed or catechized. You think about, why is the priesthood reserved only to men?
Yeah.
How can this be anything but misogyny? You know?
Right.
Well, because that's the culture that we come out of. Any kind of reservation like that must have some sort of malice behind it rather than some spiritual reality. Again, you know, motherhood is reserved to women. Men can't mother. You know, fatherhood is reserved to men. Women can't father. And this principle holds true even in the priesthood and in other vocations. So the question really is, you know, if women cannot be priests, is there some role that only they can hold that men cannot? And of course, the answer is mothers, motherhood, you know, and that applies then to sisters.
I don't know if you've ever been to California, but here men can be mothers here. That's been enshrined in law now. So.
That's right. There is this, you know, tremendous confusion about you know what these things even mean.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
Justin,
more important as ever that we have vocabulary to get into that conversation.
Justin in St. Paul, Minnesota is next on the line. Justin, go ahead with your question for our guest, Liz Kelly.
Good evening, Liz. Liz, I think you just answered my question, kind of, which was there's no indication in the New Testament that women would serve a priestly role, and certainly not in a patriarchal society of that time.
Right. Well, one thing you might want to think about, too, though, is that, you know, some people will argue the only reason that women weren't chosen as part of the 12 was because of this patriarchal system. We want to pay attention to the fact that, you know, when Jesus was choosing the 12, he had some spectacular women to choose. The Blessed Mother, first of all, if women were meant for this particular role, she would have been top of the list because she was the holiest of them all. So the fact that he does not choose her for that role tells us something really important, and we can't ignore that. Or you think of Magdalene, who just loved him so much and who had clearly, you know, had been relieved of demons and, you know, was now serving in that early church. Why not choose her? So he had plenty of spectacular women to choose from. The fact that he didn't, we want to pay attention to that. And patriarchy is another loaded word, but I'll just say in brief that it would have been understood by the Jews at that time as having to do with generation and origin, not so much male female. You know, the man rules, the woman is passive. It had less to do with that. And I could go on and on. I mean, I used to teach about the reservation of the priesthood to men for an entire semester. So there's a lot more to be said about it. But I think that's a really compelling thing to pay attention to. It's not like Jesus did not have remarkable women to choose from. He did. The fact that he did not give his mother that role, we don't want to ignore that.
Justin, what do you make of that?
Well, thank you. I'd like to know more about, you know, what you were talking about just a minute or so ago, to the idea of patriarchy. It has more to do with other things, you know, other elements or components.
Well. One other thing I would add is this, you know, if it was really about patriarchy, Jesus was so countercultural, why wouldn't he have been countercultural about that? If he was really interested in upholding some kind of patriarchal system, for example, he is the servant of servants. He washes the feet of the apostles. He's turning on its head that kind of patriarchal, I am king, I command, I have all rule, I have all power. He's turning it on its head. He's saying, you want to be a servant to servants. You know, this is what it means to be holy and to be powerful, is to serve others. So he's turning a lot of cultural norms on their head, turning them over, right? So why not turn that one over? I mean, if he was really interested in that, then why wouldn't he just break the mold and say, yes, women are going to be priests? The fact that he didn't, again, when he turns over all of these other things, we pay attention to. Here's another example. The woman, we'll go back to the woman caught in adultery. He is, in that instance, not only concerned with sexual sins, he's concerned with all sin. Whereas in that moment, they are trying to make this woman's sexual sin the most evil, the worst. And he's saying, no, you know, sins of the heart are far more corrosive, pride and vanity and lying and calumny and, you know, all of these other things. He's kind of turning the table on that as well. So we want to pay attention to the ways that Christ was very countercultural, and then the ways that he chooses not to be countercultural.
Right.
We don't want to dismiss either one of those. But Justin, there are great books written on this subject that are very, very accessible. Maybe they can post a few titles in their show notes
Something. I'm sure we can. I think Brant Petrie wrote a book about it. We'll have to think about it, though.
There's great material available that's very, very accessible. You don't have to have a PhD in Christology to read them and engage them.
Justin, thanks very much for the call. 888-318-7884, the number. We're talking about women in the New Testament. I got to ask you this because I don't want to get to the end and not ask about two of the obviously most prominent women in the Bible and Jesus' relationship with the sisters Mary and Martha. What do you make of his relationship with these sisters?
Well, I think I've got a lot of sisters. I've got four older sisters and I have two brothers. And, you know, I can kind of relate to this sense of like, oh, you know, he's got a little bit of a sense of just sort of shaking his head at one of them. But I think it's really hard to be a sister. You know, I think it's really hard to be a brother. I think the big families are just such an opportunity to grow in holiness and to grow in virtue. And what I'm struck by out of the Martha Mary story is that what he hangs on to is not Martha's hospitality. So he's stopping by, maybe unannounced. She's preparing a meal. He's probably tired. He probably needs a rest. He probably needs some hospitality. That's a great gift. It's a charism.
Yeah.
He's not saying your hospitality is bad. He's chiding her over her worry and her distraction. So when I'm operating in my charism, whatever it is, he increases and I decrease. You know, we have this experience of sort of losing ourselves in our charisms. So Martha lost this for a minute. She was getting totally into herself.
Yeah.
She was losing sight of the fact that she was in the presence of the Eucharistic Savior. You know, she stepped out of that charism. You know, when you're operating in your charism, I'm sure you've had an experience of this. You know, when I'm writing or when I'm speaking or leading a retreat or something, it's like I can go on for hours or just sort of forget how much effort I've put into something because I'm operating in a charism. That's how they work. You know, again, I decrease, he increases. And so, you know, she lost sight of that through worry, through distraction, through comparisons. and stepped out, I think, of that hospitality charism for a minute. And that concerned him. He didn't want her to miss the graces that come from operating in a charism.
Liz Kelly is our guest. We do have more calls. We have to take a quick break. We'll come right back with more of your calls for Liz. And we do have room for one or two more calls if you would like to call and talk with your question about women in the New Testament. 888-318-7884, the number, right back after this.
This is Harry Connick Jr., and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Go forth and preach the good news. It's not just a suggestion. If you want to take more seriously the command of Jesus to share the gospel with those around you, consider joining St. Paul Street Evangelization. It's a grassroots organization that brings the Catholic faith to the streets in a non-confrontational way. Visit our website, www.streetevangelization.com, to learn more. And don't forget to like us on Facebook. It's time to do our part.
Now there's a fast and easy way to get in touch with EWTN, the EWTN Everything Number. Call 1-800-447-EWTN to get the latest information on programming, special events, pilgrimages, and more. Our EWTN Family Viewer Services representatives are ready to help you with whatever your needs may be. The EWTN Everything Number. 1-800-447-EWTN. EWTN.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Liz Kelly is our guest. You can find her at lizk.org. Among her several books, many books, among her gaggle of books is a book called Jesus Approaches, What Contemporary Women Can Learn About Healing, Freedom, and Joy from the Women of the New Testament. I don't think you've said anything about freedom. So I want to ask you about that before I go back to the callers. What can contemporary women learn about freedom from the women of the New Testament?
Mm-hmm. I think the interaction that Christ has with everybody in the New Testament is directed toward freedom. That is, choosing to receive him or not. You know, he never imposes himself on anybody. He never forces himself on anybody. And so, and I think that and at least in the healing that I've experienced just in my own faith journey, there's an enormous amount of freedom that comes with that. Freedom to be who you are, freedom to believe with a certain kind of abandon, a freedom to make mistakes, you know, and to learn from them and to grow from them. But I think he has come that we might have more freedom, that we would not be slaves and in bondage to sin. So you can't ignore the gift of freedom that comes with an encounter with Christ.
888-318-7884. Harry in Erie. Oh, by the way, that was Harry Connick Jr. that Nick played just as we went out. So he did,
Thank you.
Yeah.
And then we're so cool.
Yeah, if you play Harry Connick, you're cool. Right. We are now officially cool. Harry in Erie, Pennsylvania. I hope this is Harry Connick Jr. listening on Channel 130, Sirius XM satellite radio. Harry, welcome. You got a question for Liz?
Yes, this isn't Harry Connick, though.
Come on, man. Okay, go ahead.
I was just kind of wondering, you know, I think of the Virgin Mary as being an extraordinarily strong woman, and how the modern women have distorted their idea of true strength. I mean, like, just for an example, in the middle of the night, St. Joseph has a dream, and he tells Mary, we have to go to Egypt. And she just gets up and goes. You know, modern woman would have to say, like, are you out of your mind? You're going to get up at 2 in the morning and take me down to Egypt? You know, where did we get this idea that this is strong and that is weak? It's inverted the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's the whole role of Satan in the world is to deceive and to distort. And so I think he likes to attack these fundamental truths that there's a great deal of strength in a woman who knows who she is in the Lord. And of course, he would want to pervert that. There's such a long history of that. You could even argue that it started with the Greeks, where Aristotle was struggling to understand the differences between the sexes, and he didn't have the advantage of biology and MRIs and sonogram imaging or any of that genetics. And so he thought of women, he used the expression that a woman was a misbegotten male. Take that error, we know that that's wrong, but, take that error and draw it into the centuries going forward. There were ways that that error was furthered and distorted, and it sort of led us to this notion that men were the actors, women had to be passive, all of this kind of thing. And a lot of times that when this comes up, especially in class, I'll use the example of Mother Teresa. I mean, Saint Teresa of Calcutta is probably the strongest human being on earth, and she's dead and she's still such a powerful influence. Even posthumously, she has extraordinary influence. People know her name better than they know Pope Francis or the name Bergoglio. They know Teresa of Calcutta. So I think that part of it is a fundamental misunderstanding of the role of power versus authority. Priests in the church act on the authority that has been granted to them through Jesus Christ. They're not acting on their own authority. So to say that men have all the power in the church, again, is just a distortion of and a misunderstanding of authority. I could go on about this for weeks. We talk about this for a whole semester in my class, and it's a very good question. And it's one of the reasons that I think people working in this area steer clear of words like feminism, because it's such a loaded topic. They're keen to grab onto the feminine genius, that expression that Pope St. John Paul made famous, because it doesn't have the same kind of baggage. So now Catholic theologians are talking about masculine and feminine geniuses. What does that mean? Where do we really excel? What does our femininity bring to the church? What does our masculinity, when it's properly ordered, bring to the church? And that properly ordered piece is big too. I can bring some disordered femininity to the church, and that's not what we're after.
It is fascinating. What you said, I found very helpful, Liz, if I may say, because of this idea that modern feminism is presented as a power struggle, and that's really not what Christianity is. It's not a power struggle between men and women. It's not a power trip.
Well, and we're all under the authority of Christ. A priest only has power because that has been given to him. He only has authority because that has been given to him. And, this is hilarious. I have a brother who's a priest. I watched him go from working in New York, basically on Wall Street, and giving away every single thing that he had, and getting up every morning now, and he puts on black, which is the color of death, which is a reminder to him that I am dying to myself,
Right.
And so we say, well, men have all the power. And I say, well, I have found the exact opposite. I have seen my brother grow in tremendous depth of knowledge of the authority that he has been bestowed through Christ and through his priesthood, but it's not his. It is not his. And so even just watching my brother going through seminary, becoming ordained, and, you know, now working in a seminary and working as a formator and a spiritual director has been very helpful to me in understanding that much more concretely. So I'm grateful to him for that. God bless you, John.
That's Harry. You're talking about your brother. Oh, okay. I thought you were talking to our caller.
Brother. My brother's father. Well, God bless Harry, too.
God bless you, too, Harry. You're my second favorite Harry now. Thanks, Harry.
Goodbye.
Well, he didn't like that, that I said he's my second favorite. I'm sorry. I was only playing Harry. The number 888-318-7884. We're talking about women in the New Testament with Liz Kelly. Adam in Alberta, Canada is next watching on YouTube Live. Adam, thanks for calling from Canada.
All
go ahead.
Men are calling.
I know. Have we had a single woman call yet? I don't think a single woman.
Thanks for taking my call. I just I had a quick question about about a character that the Apostle Paul mentions, the character Junia, who he kind of refers and things to as an apostle. I believe it's in Romans 16. But yeah, I'm just kind of curious of thoughts or opinions about that.
Junia. Some people think that's the same Joanna. Her name would be Joanna in the Luke's gospel. You're about Paul referring to her as an apostle, you mean?
Correct.
Okay.
I think, and again, I'm not an expert on the epistles, but I think that word has been examined, and that there are sort of layers of interpretation. So there can be, we're all called to be apostles. Absolutely. We're called to be apostles. Was she being called into like the 12? You know, that's a different term, from what I understand. But again, you know, I'm not an expert in Greek and Hebrew and.
Well, I think you have a similar thing with the word deacon for some women referred to as deaconess. Sure. These terms develop in their meaning, but I mean, it has been always been controversial in the church. Not always, but for a long, long time, it's been controversial. What does Paul mean when he calls Junia, who might also be Joanna, an apostle? But apostle means one who's sent by Christ, and certainly if Junia is Joanna, this is a person who was who visited the tomb of Jesus. I mean, she's like Mary Magdalene, and Magdalene is called the apostle to the apostles. So I don't know, Adam. Does that all satisfy you?
It's interesting. I don't know. I find the discussion about it really interesting. I saw a really interesting anti-right video on it. I find it a very interesting.
I think it is an interesting thing. I mean, the church has taken an interest in it for 2,000 years. What was Paul talking about when he called Junia an apostle? I think there's some people who are like, well, it doesn't say she was outstanding among the apostles. What it says is she was well known among the apostles. So there's some Greek problems there, but I don't read Greek, so I don't know about that.
Mm-hmm. There's also been a tremendous amount of work done on the question of deaconesses. So we have a lot of material available on that. For example, we know that the right to become a deacon or deaconess were two completely separate things that didn't happen at the same time and weren't made deacon and deaconess in the same operation of the Holy Spirit. I mean, we have a lot of scholarship on the differences in those two roles now too. So there's plenty to read if you still have questions about it.
Adam, thanks.
I'm thinking of Sister Sarah Butler. Sister Sarah Butler, she examined the question of women in priesthood and has also done a great deal of scholarship on women and as deaconesses.
Liz Kelly has been our guest. We've just been talking about women in the New Testament, so I will mention again her book called Jesus Approaches, What Contemporary Women Can Learn About Healing, Freedom, and Joy from the Women in the New Testament. She has a whole bunch of other books as well. You can find all about Liz and her books and her other work at lizk.org. Liz Kelly, thanks very much. Appreciate it.
You're welcome. It's fun. Thank you.
It's always
You're
fun.
You're cool.
Actually, oh, that's there we go. I didn't even have to fish for that. She said I was cool. All right. Every time Liz is on from now on, have a little bit of jazz music ready for her. All right. We'll see you tomorrow, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.